When it comes to consumer routers, the Netgear Nighthawk is everywhere. Costco, big box stores, you name it. But is this router any good? Like anything, the answer depends on what you need. Are you looking for something that's simple and easy? Or do you want a feature-rich router that can grow with your network, but is gonna require a little bit more time and effort to dial in? In this video, we're gonna try to determine if the Netgear Nighthawk is a good choice for you. We've got a lot to cover, so let's get started. You may have found this video because you're thinking about buying a Netgear Nighthawk and you're wondering if it's any good. With so many different technologies, devices, and buzzwords in computer networking, it can be really tough to separate what you actually need from all of the marketing mumbo jumbo. That's why I created Rogue Support, to help our customers sort through all of that BS and get online with as little hassle as possible. With Rogue Support, you simply open up a ticket, you let us know what you need, and we're gonna get you sorted out quickly. Whether your internet isn't working or if you're just trying to figure out what equipment is best for your home or business. The friendly and helpful technicians at Rogue Support are standing by and ready to assist. So give us a shot today by visiting rogue.support and you'll be well on your way to not having to think about your internet troubles anymore. I bought this Nighthawk model RS280S on sale at Costco for $199. On the box, it says it has built-in Wi-Fi 7 with speeds up to 9.3 gigabits per second. Wow. And it can cover 2,500 square feet, which is about the size of an average home. And on the surface, all of that sounds pretty great. By the way, if you're not interested in all the technical details and you just want my final thoughts on the Nighthawk, I've got time codes down in the description of the video and you can skip right to the end. Now, you cannot find this model on Netgear's website because it appears that this version is purpose-built for sale at Costco. Netgear's closest model online is the RS300, which is basically the same specs, but it's $100 more expensive. So if you're looking for a similar model Netgear router, the Costco version is a solid deal. The RS280S has a 2.5 gigabit WAN port. This is where you plug in your internet connection, and it has four LAN ports for your device. Now, two of these LAN ports are 2.5 gigabit, and the other two are 1 gigabit ports. Now, if you're just plugging in a wired device like a surveillance camera or a smart TV, the 1 gigabit ports are just fine. But if you want faster speeds, such as between your computer and a network-attached storage device like a Synology NAS, then you're gonna wanna use the 2.5 gigabit ports. Just keep in mind that anything you plug into a 2.5 gigabit Ethernet port also has to have 2.5 gigabit on the other end in order to get those speeds. Hardware-wise, this is a pretty good deal for $200. Most of the folks that watch this channel here on YouTube know that I'm big into unified network equipment, and to get Wi-Fi 7 and 2.5 gigabit Ethernet, you'd need the Cloud Gateway Ultra with a U7 Pro access point, which altogether is gonna cost you $318. Now, I'm sure that Ubiquiti is gonna come out with some lower cost Wi-Fi 7 access points in the future, but being under NDA, I wouldn't be able to tell you about that even if I knew anything about it. And I'm gonna put a link to my own recommended UniFi starter network down below. That's gonna take you to the UI product selector, which is a sandbox for designing and building out UniFi networks once you're ready to venture into that prosumer level of networking hardware. Getting back to the Nighthawk, I like the amount of hardware that they're packing into this thing for $200. But at $300, like the online version of this same router, that's kind of pushing it. So if you're interested in buying one of these, definitely try to get that Costco deal. Now, the Nighthawk comes with Wi-Fi 7, which is the latest Wi-Fi technology available today. Now, this is fine, but you do have to read a bit past the marketing to understand that Wi-Fi 7 on its own isn't really likely to increase your network speeds at all. First of all, there are very few Wi-Fi 7 devices actually on the market. Now, more and more Wi-Fi 7 smartphones and stuff like that are being released, but even with a Wi-Fi 7 capable device, if you're not transferring files across your local network, you're gonna be limited to the speed of your internet connection. And let's face it, most of the time when you're using your smartphone, you're just scrolling TikTok or watching YouTube. I mean, it's nothing that needs these like super fast wireless speeds. Besides that, the technology that goes into Wi-Fi 7 isn't designed to increase speeds for individual devices. The technology that goes into Wi-Fi 7 is meant to increase the efficiency of wireless networks as a whole that have hundreds of client devices connected, like way more than anyone's gonna have at home. Or in other words, there's really no noticeable benefit of Wi-Fi 7 over Wi-Fi 6 for home users, so don't get caught up in the marketing. Now on the box, the Netgear Nighthawk claims up to 9.2 gigabits worth of wireless speed. Wow, that sounds impressive, right? But really that's kind of a dumb statistic, given that the maximum internet speed is locked down to 2.5 gigabit by the WAN port, and as far as transferring stuff locally on the network, no one's really using wireless for that type of bandwidth. But that's not the reason why this is misleading. When they say that it has a maximum of 9.2 gigabits, they're talking about if you're saturating all three available wireless bands simultaneously. To get to that 9.2 gigabit measurement, they're adding together 0.6 gigabits in the 2.4 gigahertz wireless band, 2.9 gigabits in the 5 gigahertz, and 5.8 gigabits in the 6 gigahertz wireless band. That's a lot of gigahertz. Anyways, altogether, you add that all up, you get 9.2 gigabits. But no single device is going to use all three of those bands simultaneously. And even if there was a device that could use all three of those simultaneously, those speeds are still combining the transmit and receive speeds, which is even more misleading. It's basically like saying the total speed limit allowed on a highway is 120 miles per hour because you can go 60 miles per hour in each direction and then you just add those two together. It makes absolutely no sense. So just keep that in mind. Wireless speeds that are displayed on product boxes are complete BS, which, by the way, is not just a Netgear thing. Every wireless manufacturer does the exact same thing. Now, I did a full video on why Wi-Fi 7 marketing is mostly BS, and I'll put a link to that down in the description if you're interested in checking it out. What I recommend to anyone watching is don't spend more on Wi-Fi 7 just to have like the latest and greatest wireless technology. But if you can get a good deal on a router that happens to have Wi-Fi 7, like this $200 Costco deal, then it's totally fine. All right, hardware aside, the setup of the Nighthawk is very, very easy, which is kind of the point of these devices, right? Consumer-grade routers are for consumers who just want their internet to work. Netgear knows this, and they've taken all of the guesswork out of the setup. They even go so far as to have you unplug your old router and ISP's modem as the first step, which is actually a great idea given that the ISP's modem will often hang on to the hardware identifier of your previous router and it won't connect to new equipment without being power cycled. So that's kind of a nice touch. Once the router's booted up, you're walked through setting up the admin password, the wireless network info, and then some recovery questions before the Nighthawk updates its software to the latest version. At multiple points during the installation process, the app forces you to wait for 3 to 6 minute stretches, which definitely slows everything down, but these pauses are there to mitigate user impatience, which I'm sure causes no shortage of Netgear support tickets. It's kind of annoying to wait through these breaks in the setup, but I do understand why they do it that way. Now, once you're online and configured, the Nighthawk app itself is really not all that useful. One of the main things that I dislike about the Nighthawk is that Netgear tries to nickel and dime you for various services like parental controls and security features. So for example, if I click on Device Manager, I can create profiles for all of my family members and then assign their devices to those profiles. Now this is used for parental controls, and the idea is that you add your kids' devices to a group, and then you can schedule when those devices are active, you can set time limits, you can control the content that your kids have access to, but you can't do any of that unless you subscribe to Netgear's Smart Parental Control feature, which is $8 a month or like 70 bucks per year. And they don't tell you any of that pricing in the app, they just have a button to start a 30-day trial, you know, try to get you hooked on it. The device manager is basically completely useless if you're not subscribed to their parental control service. Another add-on subscription they try to sell you is Netgear Armor powered by Bitdefender. Netgear Armor is a suite of security features that includes scanning the network for vulnerabilities, spyware, phishing, virus protection, malware blocking, and it also has a VPN client like you get with private internet access or NordVPN. The Netgear Armor subscription is up to $45 per year, and it requires you to install software clients on all of your devices to take full advantage of the features. Now, on one hand, these are kind of like bare minimum security features that are designed to protect folks from bad guys out on the internet. So I'm glad that they've included those. But on the other hand, Netgear shouldn't be upselling customers for this stuff, right? Other than the VPN connectivity, there's nothing that Netgear Armor provides that you can't get for free somewhere else. But the target market for the Nighthawk are folks who aren't gonna spend time researching the best way to protect your network and devices from bad guys, right? So maybe they're more willing to fork out some cash to let Netgear handle all of that. Continuing through the app, we can run some speed tests. We've got some basic Wi-Fi settings, but there's no ability to change anything else, like the IP addressing, the DNS servers, or the DHCP settings. For that stuff, you have to log into the web GUI, so let's take a look at that next. You can log into the Nighthawk's web GUI by browsing to 192.168.1.1. The username is admin and whatever password you set up during the initial setup wizard, which, by the way, props to Netgear for making users set up a strong admin password rather than just having a default password. I mean, that one thing alone is a tremendous increase in the overall security of the device. The web GUI of the Nighthawk is where you're gonna find most of the settings and advanced features. So for example, when you click on wireless, you can manually set channels and channel width, though they don't call it channel width, it just says mode, and then you can pick the maximum network speed for each different wireless band. If you've hooked up a hard drive to the USB port of the Nighthawk, this is also the only place where you can set it up as network attached storage and configure permissions. You can't do that in the app at all. If we click into the advanced tab, there is a decent amount of configuration that we're allowed to do, including some more detailed internet options for PPPoE and VLANs. In those advanced settings, they do allow you to change the default LAN subnet to something other than 192.168.1.1, but they don't really have much in the way of DHCP options. They don't even allow you to customize which DNS servers to hand out to your client devices. Guests connecting to a guest network are dropped into the same network subnet as everyone else. There's no separation in network subnets between guests and non-guests, but they are client isolated, meaning that they can only get out to the internet and they can't see other devices on the network. Beyond that, there doesn't appear to be any way to do more advanced networking like additional subnets, VLANs, or access control lists. They do have some more advanced features like port forwarding, dynamic DNS, and a simple VPN server, as well as port aggregation. And get this, while you can't create additional subnets and VLANs within the Nighthawk itself, you can configure it to read VLAN tags and specify which Ethernet ports those VLAN tags are connected to, which, I don't know, I felt that was kind of weird. So let's get to the final verdict here. Is the Netgear Nighthawk any good? Let's start with the price. $200 for this hardware, I think, is a good deal. $300? Definitely not as good. So try to pick up the one at the Costco price if you can. Now, this device does have some of the latest hardware, given that it's got 2.5 gigabit Ethernet ports, it's got Wi-Fi 7 capability, which, even if you're not fully using either of those technologies, at least you're kind of future-proofing your network a bit. The Nighthawk claims a coverage area of 2,500 square feet, or about 232 square meters, which is fine, but that always depends on the placement of the device. Most people are going to install this router side by side with their ISP's modem. And if that location is in like a far corner of the house, the wireless coverage area may not extend to cover everywhere that you need it. Now, you can purchase additional Nighthawks and then just put them into access point only mode, but now you've doubled the cost. And at that point, you'd be much better off with something like Unify, where you can purchase each network component separately to fine tune the network based on your needs. Downside to that, of course, is that there's a learning curve, which is not ideal for the type of customer who's going to be buying this Netgear. The consumer grade answer to customers who need multiple access points is whole home mesh Wi-Fi, systems like Netgear's Orbi or TP-Link's Deco. Now, the problem with whole home mesh Wi-Fi is that it's incredibly expensive for absolutely no reason, right? Netgear's latest Wi-Fi 7 Orbi 3 packs range from $1,000 up to $2,300, and they really aren't that much better than having two or three of these Nighthawks connected. Now, if you're really interested in whole home wireless coverage, give us a shout at Rogue Support, and we're gonna make sure to get you into the system that best fits your needs and isn't gonna waste your money. Security-wise, what you get for free with the Nighthawk is pretty standard. You've got WPA3 Personal for Wi-Fi encryption. They make you set the admin password to something strong during the setup wizard. There's, you know, a basic firewall guarding the outside world, but they lock additional security features behind their Netgear Armor paywall. They also lock up all of the parental controls behind a paywall. The Nighthawk with all available services is an extra $115 per year for features that come standard in other solutions. Ease of setup and use is where this device really shines. It is dead simple to set up. And for most people, the default configuration is gonna be fine, so once it's set up, they're never gonna have to touch it again. Now, as far as brand reputation goes, there's no danger of Netgear going out of business anytime soon. I mean, they're huge, they're well known, but there is a downside to that as well. The reviews of Netgear support are really, really mixed, right? Lots of complaints about extended wait times and unresolved issues. Lots of complaints about Netgear trying to upsell extended warranties and services to customers. If we check them out on the Better Business Bureau, they've got a 1.06 out of 5 in terms of customer reviews. So if you buy this thing, you're gonna be pretty much on your own in terms of support. So then where does that leave us, right? This is a router for your mother-in-law or your parents or for non-technical people who don't know anything about computer networking and don't want to deal with the learning curve of logging into an interface to configure settings. When you want a router that just works without any hassle, the Nighthawk is actually a decent choice. Where it's going to start to fall apart on you is if you have any advanced needs. If you want to expand your network with switches or additional access points, if you want to set up a home lab or a separate subnet for your IoT devices, once you actually start to learn any level of computer networking, you're going to very quickly outgrow this device. Another possible use case for the Nighthawk, again, talking to a target audience of non-technical users, is for anyone who wants relatively easy access to the parental controls. So yes, it is a paid add-on service for the Nighthawk, but if you've got teenage kids and you're trying to limit their screen time or set up schedules or control the content that they're seeing, then this is gonna be a pretty decent option for that stuff. And it's not too complicated to figure all of that out. It can all be done through their app. So before you buy a Netgear Nighthawk, think about what you want in a router. And if you're the kind of person who doesn't want to think about what you want in a router, you just want, you know, Netflix and email to work, then this is a good choice. And no judgment there, by the way. I'm the same way when it comes to a lot of stuff, like cars, for example, right? I just want a car that runs well and I don't have to think about it. I have no desire to dig in and learn how to, you know, change the oil or figure out why the engine's knocking. I just want it to work for me when I need it. And when my car breaks down, I'm gonna take it to a trusty mechanic. Just like you can take your computer networking issues to the trusty techs at Rogue Support, and we'll get you back on the internet in no time. All right, thanks so much for watching, and if you'd like to keep this party going, I have hand-selected a couple videos on the right here for you to watch next. The top video is my recent review of Starlink Mini, and the bottom video is a beginner's guide to UniFi. It's a complete overview of how to get started when you're ready to go one step above this consumer-grade networking equipment.